So I'm
You know,
guessing is.
DeFi was supposed to make everything plug and play, right? So Uniswap, you can add any token you want and trade it, but it doesn't work that way with margin trading. I've been dying for some place where people could short specific altcoins, and you just can't, which sucks. So I wish people could have shorted my favorite coin and
Wait,
got the hell wrecked out of them,
wait,
but
so there's
fortunately they
margin
can't.
trading on, there are some DEXs that do margin trading at that. DYDX?
They only do Bitcoin, Ethereum, DAI, and USDC, and that's it. I think they might have just recently added like
The
maybe
other,
Link,
basically a
maybe.
handful of coins.
Yeah, and
I
that's
mean,
it.
because that's going to be reckless if people can start shorting shitcoins. It's gonna,
Okay.
well, I mean, because,
What's not reckless about margin trading in general? Like, people
well,
think low
true,
leverage is
but
5x.
yeah, but like
It's
pump and
not.
dumps, right? Because let's say retail traders try to short any project like HEX or whatever, and it just
Be annihilated.
pumps
You will be
because,
annihilated.
I mean, because your losses are not
Are
capped on the
infinite.
short,
Yep.
right? Which is why
That's
it's
why I want
reckless.
people to be able to do it. I want people to
But
have the option to disregard my advice, to not trade, and be destroyed.
all right. people in the comments, I think, would definitely did not like that. Okay, all right. So, anything else to add to that, Bill?
No, so I got a question for our guest. So your preference would be to have people lock up tokens and skip the volatility and
There's only two people that have
earn
ever gotten
yield?
rich in crypto. There's only two people that have ever gotten rich in crypto. Holders, okay, who
Right.
held from a penny to 20,000, a 2 million X return, or right now are sitting at 1.3 million X return. Pro tip, no one's beating that, okay? So the guys that shoved their thumbs up their bums and just sat outperformed everybody. Who else gets rich in crypto? Founders. Founders of what? Founders of coins and founders of exchanges. And that's it. The other guys that aren't in those two classes get harvested for yield. So where does all this money come from in a primarily closed system? If a primary closed system where the only thing people really do with it is speculate, who is getting harvested to make these mad gains? The guys that buy tops and sell bottoms, who do you think makes that money? The holders and the exchanges. And it's really that simple. So if all of personal development is delaying gratification and choosing a long-term thing over the short-term thing, and if the most profitable strategy in crypto has been to buy and hold, yeah, I monetize that just like they did in the real world. When you go to the bank, second most popular product there, time deposit. They pay 20% more interest every year. So it is, if we could get everyone to do that and stop getting wrecked, then we could already have market caps in the trillions. We could already have an ETF. We could already be using the scaling to on-ramp the whole world. But instead, people FOMO, buy tops, sell bottoms, and then when they get out, they never get back. If you look at Ian's followers or my followers or Roger Ver's followers, we all got 80% of our followers at the end of 2017, and our views have gotten less and less and less ever since because those guys that got wrecked, they never came back. And now we're at the beginning of a new bull run. We're all going to get to have this new huge blow off top again, and we will get another huge blow off top, and it'll be glorious and it'll be amazing. And this is the cycle, and we will keep oscillating, wrecking noobs who buy tops and sell bottoms all the way until changing the world. But there's no other way to do it. Like you just, you know, if you could get everyone to stop doing that and just lock up their funds and keep building up liquidity and keep building up, making everything better, everyone would live healthier, happier lives. Their girlfriends wouldn't be beating them up to get off the computer. Like it would just make the world a better place.
Now, okay, so to chime in there, I think I do agree in the sense that long-term value investors, basically hodlers, make more money than traders or speculators, right? And that's why myself, I'm really into value investing, right? So whether you want to call that being like Warren Buffett or I would say, yeah, I mean, because Howard Marks is probably the best value investor I like to draw inspiration from. And that's why we have trivias on token metrics to kind of bring things back to token metrics. Because we know, yes, people like to speculate and ride pump and dumps and do degen trading and all that. But we think the real value is captured long term, right? Because even perfect example, I got into Chainlink's private sale, when Chainlink was around 20, 25 cents, I sold at a 5x, 6x return because we were entering this bear market and they had zero marketing. I was like, zero marketing in a bear market, they're done. The rest is history. Chainlink is now top 10 market cap coin. So at the end of the day, if you find a good project, you want to get into that project long-term and stay there, right? Because Warren Buffett has this concept saying, imagine you have 20 tickets you can cash in for investments for the rest of your life. And you have to think long and hard about those investments. So to bring that to crypto, ask yourself, imagine you could only make 10 investments or 20 investments in crypto. Not in a year as trades, but for the rest of your life. I'm basically about to be 32. Imagine I live till I'm 100 years. So basically 70 years, I can only make 20 investments. That will make you think twice about what you invest in, and you're investing for the long term. And I think if more people invested like that, they'll make a lot more money. Bill, anything else to add to that, or Richard?
Yeah, I agree with that. I agree completely. I mean, I come from a serial entrepreneur background. I retired in 2003, had 150 employees, 60 million a year turnover, self-made man. Way before Bitcoin was invented, 6 years before Bitcoin was invented. Product market fit, is what you're doing working? Do you have a defensible moat? Do you have pricing power? Do you have a weird brand name? Notice the most valuable market cap companies in the world have names that don't make any sense. Yahoo, Alphabet, Amazon. Do any of those have anything to do with their businesses? No. So you learn these counterintuitive things when you become a master, and then you're like, oh, like, you know, how much does this matter? How much does that matter? Like referral program, you did that. That's important. It works. Who else does that? All the winners, you know? So once you have this like menu of the things that really matter, right? Speculative stickiness. Does it addict people? Is there anyone else that does it? How long are people engaging? Average stake length, 4.3 years. Name me another coin that's ever done that. It's never been done. That's the stuff that matters, right? Because like people talk about payments like PayPal. Guess what? It's not worth that much money. A guy buys and then gives it to a retailer and then the retailer sells. Okay, so what did the order book see? They saw buy and they saw sell. So where'd the price get left? Right where it started, except for the latency, the lag, the float. So it's not worth that much. For instance, Ethereum took over all of the payment processing, mostly for Tether. Tether used to run on Omni. Omni did $200 a day of volume, $200 US a day of volume, billion-dollar project, multi-billion-dollar project. So wait a second. A multi-billion-dollar project, the most volume in crypto, Tether, USDT, was on Omni, and Omni was worth nothing. And then they dumped all those transactions on Ethereum. Guess what? It didn't actually drive the Ethereum price up either. It's just a load on the network. It just drives gas fees up because that's not the layer of abstraction where the value is captured. So for instance, Ethereum, we see DeFi projects going up hundreds and thousands of percent, but Ethereum has only gone up like a 3 or 4x. Why? Because you don't need to buy Ethereum. You need to buy the thing that's going up a lot. Ethereum is just the substrate, the middleware. And if Ethereum tries to capture too much value in that area, there's all these other things that just take Solidity code that will take it over. So I look at Ethereum like a keyboard. A keyboard is a way you could write a novel, but the keyboard doesn't write the novel for you. Ethereum's the same thing. You can introduce something new and innovative and interesting like Uniswap, which is now 66% of all usage of Ethereum now. 66% of Ethereum usage is Uniswap, and maybe 10 or 15% is Tether. And everything else mostly is noise, right? So like when you start to look at these systems, you're like, why actually, if you look at how much money liquidity providers in Uniswap make, it's more than Bitcoin miners and it's more than Ethereum miners. Okay, well, what's the actual innovation? What's the actually important thing? What actually has the use case and the demand? The Uniswap project has more demand and use than actually Ethereum does. If you look at the numbers, like it's, it doesn't mean buy the token because it was duct taped on there. It was a public good. So everyone loved Uniswap because it didn't have a token. And then they had to duct tape one on to respond to an attack from a competitor.
All right. Thank you for that, Richard.
Pleasure.
And tell us what you think. Down-